Amen. What a blessing. Isn't it a wonderful thing this morning that for the redeemed, death don't have any hold on us.
Right.
We'll go home to be with the Lord. It's a wonderful, wonderful thought. If you have your Bibles with you, I'd ask you to turn to the book of 2 Kings chapter 20. 2 Kings chapter 20. And while you're turning there, again, continue to remember Brother Terry's father there in West Virginia that he might gain strength. 2 Kings chapter 20, in the very first verse, the Bible says, "In those days was Hezekiah sick unto death, and the prophet Isaiah, the son of Amos, came to him and said unto him, Thus saith the Lord, Set thine house in order, for thou shalt die and not live. Then he turned his face to the wall and prayed unto the Lord, saying, I beseech thee, O Lord, remember now how I have walked before thee in truth and with a perfect heart, and have done that which is good in thy sight. And Hezekiah wept sore. And it came to pass, afore Isaiah was gone out into the middle court, that the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, Turn again and tell Hezekiah, the captain of my people, Thus saith the Lord, the God of David thy father, I have heard thy prayer, I have seen thy tears. Behold, I will heal thee on the third day, thou shalt go up into the house of the Lord. And I will add unto thy days 15 years, and I will deliver thee and this city out of the hand of the king of Assyria, and will defend this city for my own sake and for my servant David's sake. And Isaiah said, Take a lump of figs. And they took and laid it on the bowl, and he recovered. And Hezekiah said unto Isaiah, What shall be the sign that the Lord will heal me, that I shall go up into the house of the Lord on the third day? And Isaiah said, This sign shall thou have of the Lord, that the Lord will do this thing that he hath spoken. Shall the shadow of go forward 10 degrees or back 10 degrees? And Hezekiah answered, It is a light thing for the shadow to go down 10 degrees. Nay, but let the shadow turn backward 10 degrees. And Isaiah the prophet cried unto the Lord, and he brought the shadow 10 degrees backward by that which is done, which is gone down in the dial of Ahaz. Lord, we thank you for your goodness and your watch care. We praise you for all that you do, Lord, for the things that we fail to see and for the magnificent things we do notice. Lord, we praise thee this morning for all of that. Lord God, we need you this morning. We need the Holy Spirit to come our way. Lord, magnify thy word in the sight of thy people this morning. Lord, we pray that you would touch the lost, that this would be the day, Lord, that you'd bring life unto them, that you'd save their miserable souls, Lord, and complete them in you, Lord. We ask these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. I'll be preaching this morning on the thought, I have plenty of time. I have plenty of time. Now, very familiar verses of scripture that we read this morning. Many, many messages preached on the extension of the life of Hezekiah. And I often point out that in this time is when his son, that would be the greatest rebel of all times, lived. So I'll say first of all, and that is not the text of the message this morning, the content of it, be careful of what you pray for. Be careful what you ask of God, because remember, He's sovereign, and He can do whatever He wants to, and He may give you exactly what you ask. Now, I want you to see that without any doubt that Hezekiah was going to die. Now, let me say this, without a doubt, you're going to die. If the Lord does not return, you will die from this life. And no one knows how quickly that will come to pass. Everybody wants to say, well, I've got plenty of time. Well, you don't know you do. It is the natural man, and that's the way that we should see that this morning. It is not a godly attribute to want to cling to life. That is of the flesh entirely. Because if we were in a spiritual mode, we would rejoice that, hey, I'm fixing to go. So when we begin to say, I want to stay here longer, as Hezekiah did, you remember that's the flesh. You remember that that is not the spirit man talking, but rather the flesh. Uh-huh. I also want you to see that he entreated God for it. And really, you know what he was really doing and asking and saying, I don't accept your plan. I don't think it's best. Now, was it wrong? Again, we certainly should entreat God over the lives and to intervene. But you be careful, careful, careful of what you pray for when you beseech the throne. You know, I really don't think most of the time we understand the power of prayer that we should. And I think if we did, we would be more careful of what we laid before Him, because we would believe and have faith that that would be what He would bring to pass. I also want you to see that he did pray, the Lord granted it, and he granted it quickly. And even before Isaiah got out of the court. Now, the best I understand, there was not a court in the king's palace. So it must have been that Isaiah went down to the house of God, and he was leaving the house of God, and before he got there, he says, go back and tell Hezekiah, I've heard your prayer, you're going to get 15 more years. Then he gives him something somewhat medicinal and say, you lay some figs on it and it'll heal you. Now, I want you to see also that that wasn't good enough for Hezekiah. That wasn't adequate. He wanted more proof. And he wanted to know in the flesh it was going to happen. You know what? If God tells you to do something, you should just have faith. And it may have seemed odd, and it may have seemed inadequate to lay that figs on the boil, but that's what God's command was. Why not accept it? Why not say, this must be what the Lord has for me. This is His means to accomplish. Why should I question it? But we do. We say, you know, that doesn't seem adequate, that doesn't seem enough, that doesn't seem praiseworthy. Let me have a little bit more. Then I want you to see that the blessing necessarily was not because of Hezekiah. Because the blessings that grew, the blessing of extended life, I guess I would have to say, yes, that was for Hezekiah. But the preservation of Israel, because they were under attack. During Hezekiah's reign, they were attacked three different times. And in Hezekiah's reign, now the Assyrians was surrounding them and ready to take the city. And he says, I am preserving this for whom? For my sake and for David thy father's sake. See, just the fact, and that gets another thought altogether, is that he was praying for himself when maybe he should have been praying for his country. Praying for the preservation of Israel. You know what? Even as believers today, you should pray for the preservation of Israel. It is very, very critical that should be a love of our life as the nation itself of Israel. And so I want you to see, in addition to the extension of life, he says, I'm going to preserve the kingdom. I'm going to make this, I'm going to continue it for my own sake and for David's sake. Now, with that information, he says, well, how will you heal me? How will I know that you will heal me? So, another thing, and again, I think Hezekiah was being selfish. He just said, I'm going to preserve the kingdom. I'm going to deliver it from the Assyrians. And we find Hezekiah going right back, well, what about me? What about me? I want to know what's happening and what's going to continue for my life. And many times we're just as selfish. We're just as interested. I want an extension. I want this longer life. What about me? What about me? And you know what? We should be a people today that's not so wrapped up in self that all we can do is what about me? Well, let me ask you this morning, what about New Testament church? What about your family? What about the state of Tennessee? What about the United States? What about something besides yourself? What about that? Now, another thing that we find about Hezekiah is he wanted this unusual sign. He wanted the time to be turned backwards. Now, first of all, I want you to see he got an extension of life. That's plenty of time, right? 15 years is a long time. I think about 15 years ago, I was just 33 years old. 15 years ago, we were meeting in the little storefront chapel building down the road. 15 years ago, my children were babies. 15 years ago, he gave him and granted him 15 years to be used of the Lord. Now, we'll find from Hezekiah's life, he did not use it for the Lord. He was interested in self. He didn't go on any grand missionary trips. He didn't spend his days down at the house of God. And I'm not down on Hezekiah because I don't know that I would have either. But I just want you to see, you don't know this morning that you have plenty of time. Also, you think about this, in addition to the 15 years that God granted him, he turned back the clock 10 degrees on a sundial. Now, a sundial makes that round in 12 hours because it obviously doesn't work once the sun is down. So, so that would be 36, something like probably 20, closer to 45 minutes that he lived again. So now we have 15 years and 45 minutes in addition to that. So you think this morning, if God in his sovereign mercy turned that clock back 45 minutes, what would you do with it? Would you use it for the Lord? Would we praise him? If I looked back and you looked back and we saw the sun moving back to the east a little bit and we saw the clock roll back some, would you do anything different? My guess is no. You know what I think concerning Hezekiah? For that incredible amount of time when it was rolling back, and then they relived that 45 minutes again, I bet you he laid in bed. He was sick, right? He wasn't going to be healed for 3 more days. You know, when he went before God and said, "Lord, I beseech thee, I have been thy servant many, many years." When he came down and said, "The Lord hath heard thy prayer, and unto thy days will be added 15 years. You don't find Hezekiah saying, "Blessed be the name of the Lord." You don't say, "Thank you, Lord God. You're mighty and sovereign and holy." You know what? I bet David would have all through the books of Psalm. It's praise, praise, praise. He didn't praise him. He said, "I need some proof." You know what? When you ask proof from God, what you're really saying is two things. I don't believe you, and I need some proof. Yeah. And so we see then that Hezekiah was just that way. And, he did get that granted. And in that 12 years, Manasseh was born. And if you'll study that out, Manasseh was 12 years old when he began to reign. So he was born within that 15 years. And I say that to say this, be careful of what you ask for because you may just get it. Anything we ask for God, we better amplify that by eternity. Because just simply asking for even a meal can impact you for the rest of your life. And we know that it did in Hezekiah's day. So I want you to see, first of all, you don't have plenty of time. You think you do. You young people think you have all your life before you. You don't have plenty of time. And what time you do have, use it for the Lord. Give everything you got to the Lord. Put yourself into it. Now, look with me in 2 Chronicles now. Now, if you're familiar with how your King James Bible is laid out, the Chronicles tell the stories of the kings from one side, and I think it's from the northern tribe, and then the kings tells it from the other side of the kingdom. By this time, they lived in a divided kingdom. There was Judah, and there was Israel, and there was kings on both sides. And they really told the kings from both sides in both. Now, if you really want a good look at something, you need to get two or three opinions. Have you ever thought about that? Get two or three ideas. If you ever see a motor vehicle accident and there's four people standing and even sees the BAM, you're going to get four different stories. Because what's important and what sticks out to you may not stick out to me. And in those days, there was different people's view of these events that happened. In other words, Hezekiah wasn't the only one that saw how it went. He wasn't the only one. So when we began to think about plenty of time, what was other people's idea of what happened to Hezekiah? Go with me in 2 Chronicles chapter 32 and verse 24. Hezekiah chapter 32 and verse 24, the Bible says, "And in those days Hezekiah was sick to the death, and prayed unto the Lord, and he spake unto him, and he gave him a sign." Now, what is a thing that you don't see? Now, I believe it happened, it just for whatever, the Chronicles didn't say it. He didn't have any warning. And I think it happened. But we see two different takes on it. And I believe in the 2 Chronicles, we have a more realistic depth. And again, I think he heard about it, just the Chronicles didn't record it. But just reading the scriptures flat out, Hezekiah received no warning. And I want you to get this morning. You will receive no warning. Now, a lot of you think about Sister Nolan, and they said, "Listen, there's no hope. You're on your way out." Well, I say, first of all, that's in the hands of Almighty God, and He can do great things. But on the flip side, she's getting some warning. If the Lord elects to take her, she gets something that a lot of people don't have the opportunity to get. She got one of those opportunities, "Set thine house in order, for thou shalt die and not live." You may not get that. You may not have the opportunity to see that coming. And so we see that the 2 Chronicles gives us a little bit different slant. We see him healed, just like the other rendering. We see that he asked for a sign, just like the other rendering. In verse 25, "But Hezekiah rendered not again according to the benefit done unto him." Now the benefit was this: he had an extended life. The benefit was this, is that he had 15 more good years to serve the Lord. But you know what? And we'll read it more clearly in a minute. He didn't render it. He didn't work it. He didn't do with what he should. You've heard, at least some of you had, of rendering lard, right? When you render lard, you get it real hot. And when the debris and the stuff we make cracklings out of comes to the top, you pull that off. He didn't render the time that he had left. You know what? If we get an extended time, we should render that. Get out the junk and get out the problems and make that a pure life unto the Lord. He did not render the time that he had. Listen, if you have 10 minutes or 25 years, render it out for the Lord. Do we got to make a living? Sure. When you're down at the workplace, speak the name of Jesus. But you know what? We don't have to make $100,000 a year. What we need, the Lord will provide. And if we go by that standard, we'll have more time to serve the Lord. I fully believe that. I fully believe that. And so we see that the Chronicles reveals that Hezekiah didn't use this time correctly. Verse 26, notwithstanding, Hezekiah humbled himself for the pride of his heart, both he and the inhabitants of Jerusalem, so the wrath of the Lord came not upon them in the days of Hezekiah. And Hezekiah had exceeding much riches and honor, and he made himself treasuries for silver and for gold and for precious stones and for spices and for shields and all manner of pleasant jewels. Now, I want you to see what he did with that 15 years is get more money and get more things. Now, sometimes we need new things, and we need to be cautious in what we desire, and thrifty with our money, because it's God's money. Me and Don have been discussing for some time, we probably need a new living room suit. And we've talked about recovering what we've got, and we've talked about just buying something new, and really haven't come to a conclusion yet. But I'll have to say this, do we really need it? I would say more than anything, and it's looking rough. You definitely can tell we have a young child in the house. But need and want is two different things. You know what? I'll say this, and when we get in the living room seat, Larry, you don't say, well, Larry went back on what he said. We'll probably get one. But you know what? When I get home, I'll kick back in my recliner and be comfortable. So do I need one? Did Hezekiah need these riches? Did Hezekiah need to spend that 15 additional years just getting a bunch of money? Because you know, when Hezekiah died, who got the money? His son. When Hezekiah died, the greatest rebel that ever lived in Israel came to the throne, and the money went to Babylon. That's what happened in the days following Hezekiah's life. And so we see that many times the things that we think are oh so important really are not. Verse 28, storehouses also for the increase of corn and wine and oil and stalls for all manner of beasts and coats for flocks. Moreover, he provided him cities and possessions of flocks and herds in abundance, for God had given him substance very much. This same Hezekiah also stopped the upper water course of Gihon and brought it straight down to the west side of the city of David, and Hezekiah prospered in all his works. Now that seems somewhat insignificant, but what it means is they literally had a running water system in Jerusalem. They ditched that water from up on the mountain and it ran through everybody's houses, just like what we have with the North Stewart Water Company, or here in Dover, they had running water in their houses, and that's fine and that's good. But was there any service to God in it? No. All it was things. You ever read in Ezra where it said they built again the water ducts? That's what they're talking about. So what happened to it? It was destroyed by the enemy. You know what's going to happen to your stuff one day? Either your children will run through it, or it's going to be destroyed by the enemy. That's what's going to happen to your stuff that we hold oh so precious. And so Hezekiah didn't put his energy into serving God, but rather he put his energy into serving himself. Verse 31. Howbeit, in the business of the ambassadors of the princes of Babylon, who sent unto him to acquire of the wonder that was done in the land, God left him to try him, that he might know all that was in his heart. Now, you get that if you underline your Bible, you underline the end of verse 31, because God sent these enemies, the enemies of God, dressed so nice, looking like friends, to test Hezekiah. You watch who you call friends. You be very cautious. Because see, God still evaluates us in the same way. God still makes an inventory of us in the very same manner. He wants to know what we're about. Now, let me say this. He knew what Hezekiah was about, but he wanted Hezekiah to know what he was about. Now, the rest of the acts of Hezekiah and his goodness, behold, they are written in the vision of Isaiah the prophet, the son of Amos, and in the book of the kings of Judah and Israel. And Hezekiah slept with his fathers, and they buried him in the chiefest of sepulchers of the sons of David and all of Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem. Now, why do you think they put him in the chiefest place? Why do you think that they buried him in the very select sepulcher? I'll tell you the reason why is because he was a politician and he was rich. It wasn't because of what he'd done for God. It wasn't because he had a prayer life that granted him a 15-year extension. So when we begin to look out and we see these great edifices that are arisen up today, our question ought to be, why did people do that? Why did they raise this thing up? And when you think about it, most of the time it's a worldly notion, because what did our Lord and Savior have? He had a borrowed tomb. He didn't have an edifice. He didn't have a big stone reared up. He had nothing but something that was borrowed from somebody else. And so we find that Hezekiah became a compromiser in those 15 years. Now, in the book of Isaiah, we get the preacher's opinion. Isaiah 39. Everybody loves the preacher's opinion, right? Unless it don't coincide with yours, right? Isaiah 39 in the first verse. At that time, may Rodak-Baladan, the son of Baladan, king of Babylon, sent letters and a present to Hezekiah, for he had heard that he had been sick and was recovered. Now, you be very careful of the presents you receive. In other words, and I don't mean somebody giving you $50, and I don't mean somebody giving you a new pair of shoes. When somebody begins to brag on you, especially if you're a preacher or a teacher, you be very careful. You know, and I used to travel to preach a lot more than I do, but when I do go, Brother Lefty, that was just a blessing to me. And you know, the best thing I can do is say, give God the praise for it. I'm just a mouthpiece. It's nothing extraordinary that I've done. Give God the praise for it. And that ought to be the heart of every man and that teaches or preaches the gospel, is give God the praise for it. Praise Him. Give Him the glory. Instead, they brought presents. Verse 2, and Hezekiah was glad of them. Somebody brings you a dozen roses, you're glad of them. Somebody brings you, you know what, again, be careful. You know, the best thing you can do, instead of considering the present, consider the source. Instead of considering what was given to you, look to from whence it came. You know, a lot of things that we attribute to blessings of God are not so. They come from a different source. And Hezekiah was glad of them and showed them the house of his precious things, and the silver and the gold and the spices and the precious ointments, and all the house of his armor and all that was found in his treasure. There was nothing in his house nor in all his dominion that Hezekiah showed them not. What kind of treasures you got? I know most say, well, I don't have much of anything. And you know, many of us, that's true. We just don't have enough. That's okay. But when someone comes to you and says, why do you live the way you do? What's your motivator? What are you going to say? Don't show them your treasures. Say it's because of Jesus. I'm saved and the Lord saved my soul. That's all they need to know. That's all they... Because you know what? The deeper things, they don't understand. If I told them and said, because I was predestined from the world began, that I would be sitting and at the feet of Jesus throughout eternity. You know what? If you didn't treasure those truths and understand them, I would feel hopeless. Well, you know, what can I do? But Hezekiah showed them all. He revealed everything. He wanted to say, look at my riches. Look at what I've obtained. Look at what I've done. So you be very cautious with that, with revealing yourself in your entirety to anyone. Verse 3. Then came Isaiah the prophet unto him, unto King Hezekiah, and said unto him, what said these men? And from whence came they unto thee? And Hezekiah said, they are come from the country, from a far country unto me, even from Babylon. Then said he, what have they seen in the house, in thine house? Hezekiah answered and said, all that is in my house they have seen. There's nothing among the treasures that I have not showed them. He showed it all. Now let me interject this. Where were those goods stored? In his house. They were not down at the Lord's house. They weren't given to the Lord. They was in his house. This stuff is mine. I earned it and it's mine. See, that happened in the 15 years. The very same man, when they were attacked by the Syrians, went up to the house of God and literally spread that letter from the Syrians out before him and said, God help me. That very same man now hoarding stuff up for himself. And don't get down on Hezekiah, because we do the exact same thing. You say, well, I don't have any money. Well, I don't have much money either. But I want what I want, right? I can't go on Saturday because I've got too much to do. I'm barely get by on Sunday because I've got too much to do. I can't do this because I'm not a speaker. I can't do that because I don't have time. That's hoarding up your treasures. Remember, we said from the beginning that moving back of the dial, how are you going to use it? Well, that moving of the dial, those minutes and seconds that we have that remain, that's your only treasure. That's all that you have. And if we don't use it unto the Lord, then it will soon be gone. The Bible says it's gone and taken away by the wind that quickly. Verse 5. Then said Isaiah to Hezekiah, hear the word of the Lord of hosts. Behold, the days come that all that is in thine house, that which thy fathers have laid up in store unto this day, shall be carried to Babylon. Nothing shall be left, saith the Lord. Right. Nothing is going to be left. You know what? Don't put your mind into this world. Don't, as the old saying goes, don't put all your eggs in one basket. This world is not our home. And if you feel comfortable here, and you're putting all your eggs in this basket, maybe you don't have your priorities straight. And maybe you need to make a calling and election sure. Because listen,
it doesn't last that long. It really doesn't.
I was thinking on my birthday, and I didn't have time to go down there. I really did. I wanted to just spin through Carlisle and just look around and see how things have changed since I was a little one, running up and down 49 Highway, and see the difference. You know what? It seems like yesterday that I was down there with my buddies, and not my bad buddies, my good little buddies, Jeff Hargrove and Greg Dew, and we would have so much fun. And I mean, we really didn't realize how poor we were until now. But just walking around, playing in the creek, stuff that really didn't cost anything. And that seems like yesterday. And you know how long ago? It was 40 years ago. 40 years. So we need to be very cautious of what we have.
We need to be very focused on what God's given us to do. We need to be very pointed and very specific in how we spend our time as the moments fly by. Verse 7, and of thy sons that shall issue from thee, which thou shalt beget, shall be taken away. They shall be eunuchs in the place in the palace, of the king of Babylon. Now, I don't know if it's just the sons born in the 15 years, or the curse extended backward in the sons that were born before these events. But he said, "Thy sons shall be eunuchs." Now, without getting too graphic, you know what a eunuch is, don't you? It's a gentleman that's been castrated, that can't father children. In other words, you're not going to have grandchildren. There's not going to be an heir to continue. Now, those of us have understood the pure joy of picking up a grandbaby, and he's saying, Hezekiah, they'll never, ever come. They won't arrive. So now, where is his priorities? Can that gold and silver be an issue? And by that I mean an issue that comes out of the man. That would be his children, his grandchildren. So he's saying, Hezekiah, you've missed the boat. You don't even know what your treasure's about. You don't even know what's precious, Hezekiah. You've missed the boat. These 15 years you've wasted completely, all in trying to impress other people. You know what? It should not be our interest in impressing others. But very often it is. Verse 8, and we'll finish. Then said Hezekiah to Isaiah, "Good is thy word of the Lord. Good is the word of the Lord which thou hast spoken." And he said, "Moreover, for there shall be peace and truth in my days." Now, a couple of things about the selfishness of Hezekiah. Number one, he did have the wherewithal to know if God spoke it, it was going to be. But what was his motivator? "For it's going to be good in my days." So, how much are we like Hezekiah? How much are we that have an extended life and then waste it? You know, I've told some about when I was born. I was born with a tumor that had already destroyed my right kidney even before I was born. And then 7 months later, they removed the kidney. And I didn't even know this then. Everybody says it wasn't cancer, but the best I can find out, it was a Wilms tumor, which is a type of cancer. But anyway, neither here nor there. If they hadn't have done it, that I would die. Then 7 months later, they had a complete abdominal obstruction from scar tissue. Mom took me to Fort Campbell. Dad was still in the Army. And they did a huge surgery, and after 12 hours, they came out, And Mom said, "How is he?" He said, "All we can tell you, Mr. Lafferty, is we've moved him from the critical list to the very critical list." Now, back then, I didn't really understand that. I heard that story all my life. But what critical means, well, my nursing knowledge, it can go either way. It's critical. It may go this way, and he may die. It's critical. We don't know yet. And in God's sovereign grace, he preserved life, and I fully believe the only reason he preserved life is so that I would have children and that I'd preach the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's that. And you think, "Oh, but you've done so much more." No, I haven't. I enjoy being a nurse. But what is that in time and eternity? I enjoy the place where we live. It's very rural. It's kind of, doesn't it have a mailbox right now? But it's home. But does that really mean anything? No. My dad grew up in a mining town. They had what was a 3-room shotgun house. That means you could stand in the front door and shoot straight through to the back door. And raise 11 children in a shotgun house. Think, oh, how sad. I've seen pictures of Melbourne where he lived. It's gone now because the mine went dry. It looked deplorable. All the houses covered with black coal dust. I mean, you go, how could you bring up children in that? Does it really matter? In time and eternity, does it really matter? You know what I can say about my father is that he did profess salvation before he died. And I've told you this before, he said to me the day before he died, "Larry, it's all been in vain." Can you imagine living 62 years and that be the own summation of your life? We don't need to be a Hezekiah. We need to count every day precious and use it full throttle. And if you are given extension, as Hezekiah was, double throttle it. Because you